Good morning, everyone, and welcome to today's session on succession planning. I have Deepak Bholusaria ji with me, who is our ex-chairman and founder member of FTAP, and none other than our own Gagan Bhai. Gagan Bhai is a chartered accountant come advocate. He practices in High Court and Supreme Court, and he would going to take us through succession planning from the perspective of Hindu Succession Act as well as Income Tax Act. So currently, you know, I am trying to set up a live session on Facebook, and thus I would be needing 2 minutes. Gagan Bhai, if we can wait for 2 minutes.
By all means,
start this session. So I think live streaming started. Just let me check, Gagan Bhai, whether now it's live on Facebook or not. It went live somewhere. Where it went live? Let's see. Just 1 minute, bhai.
In the meantime, there is one general question being asked by one of our attendees. Will this seminar be uploaded on YouTube or in any other manner available as recording? First of all, I would like to know your name, sir, because the name it is appearing is as Galaxy M30, as I believe this is your name of your mobile phone. But yes, this recording will be available for all of our members who are FTAP members. So it will be, yes, it will be definitely available, and we will also share link to this recording as soon as this webinar is over. Thank you.
Because the net is slow, you know, I'm not able to connect to Facebook.
Gaurav, in that case, we can connect to YouTube.
But in the same thing, actually, the problem is in live streaming, it is taking time. So
yeah, because net today is a little bit slow.
Yeah. So we can start our session.
In any case, I am recording this session, so we can upload it later on.
So yes, we can start this session. So I would request you, Deepak, to please initiate this session and start it.
Thank you, Gaurav. Thank you, everyone, for joining us in fourth webinar, if I'm not wrong, in the series of webinar being organized by FTAP. This topic being taken by Mr. Gagan Kumar, who is also a chartered accountant as well as advocate. This session was originally planned for our Jaipur conference, which due to coronavirus scare has been postponed right now. So we thought it would be prudent that we can take this up, this topic right now. And this topic is affecting all of us in one way or another, because ultimately at one point of time, we have to go to our heaven board, and we have to leave our estate for our children and our legal heirs. So Mr. Gagan Kumar will be telling us how to plan our estate, how to plan our taxes, what steps we can take, what are the provisions of Hindu Succession Act, what are the provisions of death taxes, how it will impact us, how it will impact our legal here. So now, without wasting much of the time, I will request our today's panelist, Mr. Gagan Kumar, to kindly take over this session. Gagan Kumar ji, welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Deepak ji. Thank you, Gaurav ji. First of all, good morning. It is actually we have lost the sense of the day of the week, but I'm glad that Gaurav ji insisted that I should speak on one of the weekdays. So at least I know today that it's Tuesday. Otherwise, for the last many days, it is appearing to be a series of Sundays only. And I'm sure we all have been already woken up by the Prime Minister's address. So it's an incidentally, I'm speaking after the Prime Minister has already spoken. So just to give you a brief background, India has always been an industrialist nation, and as per my research, by 1930, India was the 10th most industrious nation. And gradually, we started depleting, and largely because of the various laws, and particularly MRTP and other laws, because of which the structures were not being permitted. Under MRTP, the law was that if a company has to expand, having a wealth of more than 100 crore, it required certain approvals. So that resulted in having multiple companies and cross holdings. So if you see, essentially only Reliance and Bharti Group grown exponentially during that period, because they were set up close to late 70s or 80s. Now, why succession planning? And if you see the current generation, the youngsters which are coming out of colleges or who are being inducted into the businesses, their first and foremost aspiration is that they want to follow their passion. They are also at times feel burdened by the family expectations. And they want family to have open conversation about wealth and succession planning. Now, we are going through a lockdown period, and I'm sure most of our clients would have got time to consider this aspect, that God forbid if anything happens, because ultimately this virus has given us one realization that we all are mortals. So what to do if, God forbid, if any unforeseen eventuality happens? Now here, before we touch upon the legal aspect, and it is important to understand the bit of psychology behind it. And when we say succession planning, so I may sound a little philosophical or spiritual, but what need to see that a founder of any organization would not want his efforts to go wasted. Whatever hard work he has done, he would not want that the same level of hard work is to be done by the next generation. So what we need to understand from a founder's perspective essentially is his identity. I'm not talking about the famous song, Bulla ki jana main kaun. I'm not talking about identity as in that sense. But what I'm talking about is that how do I, being a founder, identify myself? If I identify myself, just to give you an example, if I identify myself as a Punjabi or whatever caste I belong to, then everything associated with that particular caste look nice to me, and everything else may not look as nice to me. If I expand my identity further, and if I see myself as an Indian, everything related with India looks nice to me, but other things may not look nice to me. Similarly, in a case of a succession planning, first of all, we will have to understand how our client, who is the founder of the business, is seeing himself. Is he seeing himself as a business owner, or is he seeing himself merely as a parent? Because a balance would have to be achieved. Unless that balance is achieved, he will be conflicted between two identities. And the classic case, one of the classic cases I'll be taking up during this presentation is the Raymond's business model. And then you'll see that how that identity is important. So therefore, the real risk essentially lies in maintaining a balance between these two identities. The moment balance is tilted towards one identity, it creates challenge. Now, just to give you another example, in succession planning, and if you get a chance, please go through the succession planning of the famous Rockefeller family of US. Now, Rockefeller family, the founder made wealth by doing business in oil and oil refineries. And it is said that at one point of time, his revenue was more than the GDP of United States. And at the same time, there was another family of US, which also grown around that phase only. I think their name is, just tell you, Vanderbilt. So Vanderbilt family also made their fortune in business around that period of time only. And you would be surprised to know that Rockefeller family, despite more than a century, they're as rich as they were, whereas Wunderlist family has practically vanished. It is said that the last descendant died as a pauper of that family. Now, coming to today's objective, I will essentially touch upon the ways, legal ways in which succession planning can be carried out and the tax implications related around that. If you see broadly, there are three circles of succession planning. The innermost circle, you may call it the family. The middle circle, you may call it honors. And the third circle is management. What is most critical is to maintain the ownership. In the Indian perspective, if you got a study from somewhere, what it says is that only 30% of the businesses survive in second generation. And only 13% in the third generation. And only 3% goes beyond the third generation. Here I am reminded of a famous quote by author Helen Keller. She said that there is no king who has not a slave among his ancestors, and no slave who has not had a king among his. So it looks like a cycle that someone who has built an empire has not, so the statistic proved that only 3% of those families go beyond third generation, and the rest of that may not survive beyond that. Now, under the Indian scenarios, we have a few families which have lasted more than 100 years. I'll be sharing this presentation after this session. And Gaurav Bhai or Deepak Ji may share it with, and that contains a list. It essentially lists
Gagan Ji, if you want, you can share this presentation right away also. There is an option of share screen on the bottom of your dialog box. You kindly choose that share screen, or you can also email that to me and I will share it with my participants if you want to.
Yeah, I'll just email it to you.
Please. I believe if we demonstrate this presentation in the live session, it will be very useful for all of our participants, I believe.
Correct.
So. In the meantime, Gaurav, can you please check? A lot of participants are reporting that they are not able to log in. Even though we already have 83 participants, in fact, now 86.
Deepak ji, I couldn't find your email. I've mailed it to
Sir, Gaurav. deepak@bholusaria.com. Let me send you one test email. Gagan@kishnomics.in.
Yeah.
So I've just sent you an email. Today the net even is going a little bit slow. Yeah, I have already sent it. Please check.
Yeah, I've received
it.
Yes, Gagan, bhai, kya hua?
No, sorry.
Gagan ji actually sending a PPT to me. Then I will share it with my participants.
Okay.
So I will request my attendees to kindly have a little bit of patience for another 2 or 3 minutes. I believe it has been... Yeah. Gagan ji, I believe I have received this.
Yeah.
So you may please carry on. In the meantime, I will set it up.
Yeah. So I was saying that in the Indian context, there have been a host of companies which have lasted more than 100 years. Just to name some of them is Bombay Burma, Bombay Dyeing, Century Textiles, Indian Hotels, Tata Steel, Mafatlal Industries. So these are the companies which have been in existence for more than 100 years. Now, how do we carry out a succession planning? As I said in the beginning, first of all, we will have to ensure what is the mindset of our client who is willing to or who is contemplating carrying out a succession planning. From a legal perspective, there are three broad alternatives. One is by way of will. The second is
sorry
by
to
way
interrupt
of,
you. Yeah. Gaurav ji, you have to enable screen sharing. I believe it has been disabled at your end. Can you please do that? Gaurav ji, are you with me?
I am there. Let me. So you can share screen, Deepak. I don't think there is problem.
Because whenever I say share screen, it says host disabled participant screening sharing. So I believe you have to right click on my name and then you have to enable that facility to me.
I think now you can do it.
Yeah, thank you. I believe it's being displayed on everyone's screen.
Yeah, it's displayed.
Yeah, Gaganji, if you want, I can also give you the control and you can control this PPT at your end also.
Yeah, that would be easier.
I have just given you the control. If you can see, you can accept this control at your end.
I apologize to audience. We are not that tech savvy, so.
No problem. In that case, I can also manage it. Let me do the control, sir.
Okay. So you please come to the slide on modes of succession. So.
Okay. Just let me know where to stop. This is the right screen.
Yeah. So as I was saying that there are broadly three ways in which we can carry out succession planning, either by way of will or by way of trust or by way of family arrangement. here we will have to appreciate what is the intention of the client in terms of carrying out succession planning. Because as you know, that a will can only be carried out once the testator has already passed away. Trust is something which can be carried out during his lifetime. Family arrangements are usually entered when there is a dispute in the family and some partition has to be carried out. So depending on each scenario, we may have to go through it. Yeah, next slide, please. Now, as I said that the classic case of conflicting identity, the Singhania family entered into an arrangement and somewhere in 2007, Mr. Vijaypat Singhania gifted all his holding in Raymond to his son, Mr. Gautam Singhania. Now, the company had a huge apartment which as per the settlement was to be retained by Mr. Vijaypat Singhania for his personal use, but was to be transferred at a nominal price. Now, when the issue went up to the board, Mr. Gautam Singhania, despite being son, objected to it, saying that that would be to the detriment of the interest of the shareholders of the company and therefore I will not allow it. So, as a result, Mr. Singhania, the senior Singhania, felt hurt, and I understand that presently he has already moved a petition before Bombay High Court calling the gift as null and void and it be redeemed back to him. I couldn't find out the fate of that order. I understand that it is still pending. But this is a classic example where if you are not sure which identity you have to maintain, be it of a father or a business owner, these kinds of unfortunate incidents may arise. Next, Deepakji. This is a case which we all would have read in news, that when Mr. Dhirubhai Ambani passed away, he passed away intestate. He didn't leave a will behind him, nor he carried out succession planning during his lifetime. And we all are aware of the bitter battle and the washing of linen in the dirty linen in the public. And ultimately, some settlement was reached when the mother intervened and finally some settlement happened and we all know what happened thereafter. Next picture. Now, will essentially is a document by which a testator passes on his bequest to the beneficiaries. Now, these beneficiaries can be anyone. It need not be registered, but it is better it is registered. It is not necessary that the beneficiaries have to be someone from the family only. It can be anyone from outside the family as well. And I'm reminded of that Calcutta case where the chartered accountant was one of the beneficiary, Mr. R.M. Lodha, if I remember correctly the name. And that went into a dispute. Ultimately, Mr. Lodha won that battle. Yeah, next. Now, if you see the law governing will, if there is no will, then the provisions would be governed by Hindu Succession Act. And for today's discussion, I am only touching upon briefly upon the Hindu Succession Act. So in a situation where the person dies without leaving a will, as the case in the case of Mr. Ambani, the property would first go to class 1 heirs. If there is no class 1 heir, then it will go to class 2 heir. If there is no class 2 heir, then it will go to agnates. If there is no agnate, then it will go to cognate. So most of us who are chartered accountants may not get these terms. So just to give you a brief outline and then we may have our own research. Class one heirs are essentially spouse, mother, son, daughter, son of predeceased son, daughter of predeceased son, widow of predeceased son, son of predeceased son. So essentially the first layer, that's class one here. And then comes the class two here, which cover other relatives. Agnates are essentially the male lineage and cognates is the female lineage. Now, the Hindu Succession Act also applies to broad term of Hindu, as per the Hindu Succession Act includes Buddhist, Jains, and Sikhs, which are regarded as offshoot of Hinduism only. And it also covers a situation where parents were Hindu, but the children have converted, or the children who have reconverted as Hinduism. Next slide. Now, there are certain states where a will need to be mandatorily probated. Probation essentially means that it need to be certified by the court as a genuine will. So, like in Delhi, it is not mandated, but states like Kolkata, Chennai, or Mumbai, it is mandated to get the will probated. And if it is an interstate will or a case of an invalid will, then court appoint administrator and the division happens as per the respective personal law. Yeah, next. So as I said that Hindu succession law, till the time it was uncodified, we used to follow the personal laws, Dayabhaga school or Mitkarsha school, but now it has been codified. So we go by the Hindu Succession Act, which I have briefly touched upon earlier. So next slide. Coming to the trust, broadly, trust has three parties. One is the settlor. Settlor is the person who creates the trust. Then we appoint someone as trustee who will watch out for the property in the trust. And the third segment would be of the beneficiary. Beneficiary would be the people for whom trust is created. I'll touch upon the private and in the subsequent slide, but essentially this can be a revocable trust, irrevocable trust, discretionary trust, or determination of combination of all. But usually for succession planning, we make irrevocable trust, and sometime to avoid disputes, we make a determinate trust, but it may also be a discretionary trust. What are these terms? I'll explain in the subsequent slide. Deepakji, next, please.
Gaganji, sorry to interrupt.
Yeah.
I would like to ask my participants to kindly hold on to their questions till the time Mr. Gagan Kumar is presenting his presentation. Be sure that we will take up all of your questions, but only after Mr. Gagan Kumar is through with his presentation. Thank you.
Yeah, I will take up all the questions. Next slide, please. Now, for succession planning, so broadly trust are of two types, private trust and public trust. Public trust, as we all know, that they are for the welfare of the public. So they are mostly charitable in nature. So that may not affect our discussion for today. What we are interested in is in the private trust. Now, private trust is governed by the Indian Trust Act. And within that, we will have the further division. Deepakji, next slide, please. Now, when a settlor puts money into a trust, that is specifically exempt from the definition of transfer by way of Section 47 of the Income Tax Act, and therefore that does not constitute a transfer. Now, an issue arose when Section 56 was introduced, that what would happen if a settler creates a trust for the benefit of his children, since obviously it is without any consideration. So the question arose whether 56(2), 7 and 7A, or as they gradually evolved, would be covered. Now that controversy has now been finally settled by way of amendment in Section 56(2), 7, 10, Clause 10, wherein it has been said that if a trust is created for the benefit of the relatives, then that would also be outside the purview of Section 56. So in other words, money can be, or property can be, transferred to a private trust if the beneficiaries are going to be the relatives as per the definition given in the Income Tax Act. So in other words, such a transfer would not be subject to tax either for the purpose of capital gain or under the head income from other sources, because both are out of Section 56 now. Yeah, next slide, Deepakji. Now, as I said, that we can have a trust, either a specific trust or a discretionary trust or a revocable trust. Revocable trust is generally not preferred and not even regarded for tax purposes as a separate entity. So for the sake of our discussion, we will focus only on irrevocable determinate trust and irrevocable discretionary trust. Now, what they denote essentially, what it denotes is that in case of a determinate trust, the settler would have defined how much share of income or wealth would go to which beneficiary. So it is predetermined. There is no discretion left to the trustee as to in what manner the income of the trust is to be distributed amongst the beneficiaries. Whereas in case of irrevocable discretionary trust, that trust discretion is given to the trustees. Coming to the tax aspects, one thing we'll have to understand, that a trust is taxed by it through their trustees, and the status of trustee would be of the same as of the beneficiary. So if the beneficiaries are individual, as would usually happen in case of a succession planning and a family trust, the status of trust would also be, for tax purposes, as an individual. So the tax rates applicable on an individual would apply. But if it is a discretionary trust, then it gets taxed as an AOP, and the maximum marginal rate applies to it. Next slide. Yeah, this I've covered. We can move to the next slide. Now, whether to form a trust or whether to do a succession planning by way of will would depend on facts of each case. What is the comfort level of settler, that is in case of trust or
Ganji, sorry to interrupt you.
Yeah.
Actually, I have received 3 or 4 requests from our members that volume they are listening to is little bit low. Is it possible at your end to boost the volume of your microphone, if at all possible, even though it's clearly audible at my end, but already I have received 4 requests, so I thought it would be prudent to interrupt you.
Yeah, is it better now?
Only members have to tell me. Members, please let me know, particularly Ram Gupta ji, Abhishek ji, and Bansal ji. You have to let us know whether it is audible right now or not.
I think this is.
I think there is no answer. I think we can proceed with, sir.
Okay. So as I was saying that the choice of vehicle, if so as to say, between trust, will or family arrangement would entirely depends on facts of each case, and there is no straitjacket answer for that. And it would ultimately depend on what is the dynamics within the family, what is the vision of the founder or the person who is at the helm of the affairs, in what manner he wants to settle this issue. But largely, by and large, in my experience, what we have seen is that trust is the most preferred choice, because they want to settle the issues before or rather during their lifetime alone. And depending on the capability of each of their children, they divide businesses. So trust is usually the preferred way. But if there are, for example, a very small family, then sometime they adopt the will route as well. And also looking at the cohesiveness of the family, it may affect the decision-making process. Yeah, next, sir. Now, family arrangement, I said in the beginning, usually carried out when there is a bickering in the family or dispute going on in the family. Now, there are Supreme Court judgments which says that any transfer of asset by virtue of a family arrangement is not subject to capital gains. So that is something which must be kept in mind. And it has to be carried out in a very detailed manner. The drafting of family arrangement is very crucial. However, one need to be careful of the stamping, because if it is not stamped properly, it may not be regarded as an admissible instrument in court of law. So depending on the kind of assets which are distributed, stamping would have to be done, and that's something which need to be taken care of. Next, sir. Now, whether GAR provisions can be invoked or not, as we all know, we have all have read GAR provisions very threadbare. If they sense that there is some malice behind this settlement, either by way of creation of a trust or family arrangement, then yes, GAR provisions may be invoked. Otherwise, normally, if it is a bona fide transaction, GAR provisions may not be invoked. Now, I'll be happy to take any questions.
Are you through with your presentation, Gaganji?
Yes, I am through with the presentation.
Okay, great. So, I am opening house for the question answer session now. Yeah. So first question, Gaganji, we have received from Mr. Tanmay Gupta, who is from Mathura, I believe. He wants to ask how to divide the ancestral property when HUF is challenged by one of the co-partners.
So, in case it is an HUF, then you may have to first go for the partition of the HUF, and that would happen by way of a court, the civil suit only. Once you are successful in that, then obviously, as per the court order, the properties would be divided.
I believe, Tanmay, your question has been answered. So next question is from Mr. Deep Jain from Faridabad.
Yes, sir.
He wants to ask, what about registration of will containing immovable property?
So as per Section 17 of the Registration Act, any document which has the effect of transferring an immovable property, it ought to be registered. But a will is generally not a transfer as such at the time of making the will. So therefore, the best of my knowledge, it need not be registered. But it is always better to get the wills registered, because it avoids dispute at a later stage.
Thank you. Moving on to the next question. It is from Mr. Nitin Goyal. He wants to ask regarding probation of will. What about UP and Haryana?
UP and Haryana, I think, do not have the state laws which require probation of will. It's the old princely states, and if I remember correctly, it's the old princely state of Bengal and Madras, which is now the Chennai and Tamil Nadu and other areas, and to certain aspect of certain areas of Maharashtra side. So these are the three broad states, to the best of my memory, which require probation.
Great. Moving on to the next question from Mr. Abhirup, who is also a member of FTAP. He wants to ask, stamp duty applies on property transferred to specific trust or not?
It would apply. Because it the property, immovable property, would have to be transferred by way of a conveyance deed. And therefore, as far as stamp duty is concerned, I don't think there is any exception. Although there is an exception under the capital gain that it would not be subject to capital gain. But as far as stamp duty is concerned, I don't think there is any exception on that.
Okay. So next question is from Ms. Akshi Singhal. She wants to ask, sir, in case of an irrevocable determinate trust where all beneficiaries are individuals, the income of the trust will be taxed as per the tax slab and the tax will be paid by the trustee, which is a PTC, as a representative trustee.
Correct.
This is the question of Ms. Akshi Singhal.
Yeah, that's correct. And you may refer to the Delhi High Court judgment in SAE head office, which relies on Nizam of Hyderabad judgment, which essentially deals with the how, what would be the status of trust where the beneficiaries are individuals.
Next question is from Mr. Anil. If PAN in case of private trust is to be applied as individual, AOP or trust? Basically, he is confused whether the PAN for a private trust has the what is the status in the application form which he has to apply in.
Well, he is not alone. I also had faced this issue, and ironically, the PAN was when I had applied it many years ago for a trust. We had to apply it under AOP because it was not just being accepting as an individual. Although while filing return and for tax calculation, we adopted the status as an individual. But that remains a challenge which needs to be taken up with the authorities.
Next is from Mr. Devinder Singh Nagpal. Could you please quote the Supreme Court case in which it is held that family arrangements are not taxable?
Yeah, I'll give me some time. I'll just find out and I'll message you.
Devinderji, we will source this citation from Mr. Gagan, and then we will provide you in our members group, or you can also DM me and I will provide you as soon as I receive it from Mr. Gagan. Gaganji, can a charitable trust be a beneficiary of the private trust? This question has been asked by Mr. Nitin Goyal.
I think so. Yes, there is no bar on that. In fact, many people, I did a will where we did create a trust by way of a will. So there's no bar on a charitable trust being the beneficiary of the private trust.
Okay. Next question is from Mr. Shubham Goyal. How and where should I do detailed study on succession planning?
Well, in this age, there's hardly any lack of resources. You can carry out your own research by way of looking at the respective section, or you can go to YouTube, or there are books also available in the market on succession planning. So there's ample resource available.
Mr. Sushil Jain, how the succession of HUF property takes place? Is partition only way out? Can partition be unequal? So basically, there are one question and there are two sub-questions.
So yes, HUF, in the case of HUF, partition is the only way out. And it can be unequal because during the course of civil suit, each party would make their case, and depending on how judge takes a call, it is quite possible that it could be unequal.
Okay, from Mr. Vijay Gupta. Sir, any particular format and need to notarize or register? I believe he is talking about the will or a partition document, if I'm not
well, incorrect. Yeah, I also understand that it probably refers to the will. There is no particular format. We have had cases where the mother wrote on a simple piece of paper in Hindi that the property is to be divided amongst brothers in this format, and that was held to be good. So there is no format, but it is better that it is unequivocally clear. It is not ambiguous, because if it is ambiguous, it throws a lot of challenges. Like, just to give you an example, we had a case where the parent said that the parties, the brothers will have a half share in the property each. There was one property only, and the one brother took the ground floor, the other brother took the first floor. Now, gradually, they evolved this philosophy ke sab jo upar rehta hai wo upar wala to uska hai to upar to wo teen kamre aur bana dega. So those issues arose that okay, what is the definition of equal? So yes, there is no format as such, but our advice is that whenever a will is drafted, please make sure that it is not ambiguous.
Gaganji, you have just said there is no such format. But I believe any will, like any document of contract, must have certain contents which must be taken care of before drafting the will, so that tomorrow there are no more litigation or challenges are not made for that will.
Yes, you're right that certain aspects must be taken care of as to the definition of the property which are to be devolved upon, and also the beneficiaries. It need not state that why are you giving particular asset to one beneficiary, but the list of the asset and the which asset will go to which beneficiary should be clearly demarcated. That much clarity should be there in the document.
So with this, Mr. Vijay Goyal's question, can you please also illustrate the important parts of a standard document of will? I believe it's already been taken care of.
Yes.
Okay, Bharatji's question, sir. If a trust is created, property transferred in trust, and later on, say 20 or 30 years down the line, family wants to divide the trust, whether it is possible, and yes, if yes, what are the tax implications?
So essentially, we are contemplating a dissolution of a private trust. I think it is not possible. I'll have to get back to you on this. I did a research long time ago, but I think it is not possible.
So Bharatji, we are parking this question of yours, and then we will get back to you with the correct answer, whether it is possible or not. Moving on, Mr. Vipin Agarwal's question. Sir, what is a joint will? And in case of some joint properties held by husband and wife, whether it is advisable to go for a joint will?
Certainly not, because joint will essentially indicates that two people have made one will. Now, it may happen only in a unique case where both the people die on the same day. So, it is not advisable, and I don't think it is even recognized in law.
Again, Ms. Akshi Singhal's question, please throw some light on applicability of stamp duty on transfer of immovable assets to a private trust set up for the benefit of relatives.
So as I said, that stamp duty is a different issue, and there is no exception to the best of my knowledge. So therefore, any instrument which transfers immovable property to a private trust, that would have to be stamped accordingly.
Okay. Mr. Sushil Jain's question. What do you exactly mean by probation of will?
So probation of will essentially means that the will has to be certified by the court as the genuine will.
Is stamp duty payable on family settlement deeds, Gaganji? This question has been asked by Himanshu Agarwal.
Yes, if there are certain immovable properties as part of the family settlement, then yes.
Okay. Why the registration of will necessary? As the way I understand, the registration of will don't guarantee the validity of will. I don't have the name of the gentleman or lady asking this question. So I'm just putting this question before you.
It is certainly not necessary, but it is always advisable that the will get registered. Otherwise, see, again, I said that as in the beginning, that it all depends on the nature of the relationship amongst family members. If they are very cohesive, they may even agree on a piece of paper. Otherwise, even wills are challenged every day in the court. So there is no guarantee as such, but it is always better that, and it is generally seen that a registered will is less prone to challenges as compared to an unregistered will.
Gagaji, is there any tax on receipt of property on dissolution of trust? Question has been asked by Alka.
No, there is a CBDT circular, not on the dissolution, I am not very sure, but distribution of asset by trust, that is exempt.
Can you explain difference between private trust and will, which one will you recommend? So by Mr. Vinod Rawal.
Yeah, as I said during the presentation also, that the choice of vehicle, whether to form a trust or whether to transfer the assets by way of a will, would entirely depend on the vision of the person, situation in the family, and the cohesiveness of a family. So there is no straight answer to that, but it would entirely depend on the facts of each case.
Now, again, a question on stamp duty. Will stamp duty on immovable property be levied as part of the will at the time of the will or once the conveyance actually happens? What is the basically the cause of action or time of action? So time of levy of stamp duty.
Yeah. So if the property is transferred by way of will, then there is generally no stamp duty. But I guess the question appears to me is that what if you write the immovable property as one of the property in will, and do you need to pay stamp duty? If that is the question, then certainly no, because there's no conveyance of the property until the will is executed.
Gaganji, isn't it better to structure succession through HUF as it does not have any stamp duty and all the benefits of private trust are also available?
So HUF would essentially mean that there is some undivided family and there are certain assets into it. If there is, and also this would happen only upon partition. So depending on where the properties are, because in present day scenario, I don't see anyone creating any new HUF. We are living in the age of a nuclear family. So except probably for the ancestral property, I don't see that there are any HUFs, and it would again would depend on the facts of each case.
Sachin Bhutaniji is from Rohtak. In case of a family arrangement has been arrived between brothers, and this arrangement is also in writing, suggested by both the brothers and witnesses, but stamp duty has not been paid. So in this scenario, will this family arrangement agreement enforceable in court of law? And it is a question from the perspective of state of Haryana.
So stamp duty is a curable defect, and one can pay it later on also. And once it is paid, then it would be payable. It would be admissible.
Now, does the execution of will would not require probate after death of will maker? I mean, he basically wants to ask whether probation is mandatory or not.
Depends on the state. Depends on the state in which will is executed.
So can you just give us a law which is in Delhi?
In Delhi, it is not required to be probated.
What is the stamp duty rate in case of will in Uttar Pradesh? I believe, again, it's a very specific question. I believe
it won't be
possible for us to go rate specific questions. We can talk about what is the law, but as far as stamp duty rate is concerned, I will suggest my curious Mr. Chanchal Kumar to look at the notified stamp duty rates in that state, and then it can be found out.
Yeah, but just to add on one point here, that in case of will, there is no stamp duty required.
Okay, there is one more question from Mr. Chanchal Kumar. Can agriculture land be made subject to will in Uttar Pradesh?
I am not very sure on the state law on that aspect. I will have to check. But I don't see any issue.
From Mr. Jatin, in case of private determinate trust, does trust has to pay tax and the income distributed to beneficiary as tax exempt, or beneficiaries have to include their share in their return of income?
It is tax exempt. The distribution is tax exempt. The tax is to be levied in the hands of trust.
Can a person challenge a will? How to check the invalid will? Basically, what are the parameters to check whether the will is correct or not or incorrect?
Your doubt only. If you suspect that will has been signed under coercion, or will is not genuine, signatures are forged, or the person could not have doubted the could not have given property to a particular beneficiary, then these are the reasons for you can challenge it before the court.
Gaganji, is there any way to verify the authenticity of a registered will?
You can obtain a certified copy from the registrar.
And from where it can be obtained?
Sub-registrar's office, where it is registered.
Is there any stamping in case of family settlement?
Yes, that goes back to the same question of stamp duty on family settlement, which we have already addressed.
Can HUF gift a sum of money to Karta? If yes, then any taxation issue?
It can be gifted, but the tax implication would, I'll have to check section 56, but I think there would be tax issues unless it is specifically exempt under section 56, then there would be taxes. Yeah, I'll get back to you on that question as well.
Okay. Mukesh Srivastav, there is one private trust who had capital gain. Now, trustees of this trust is a private limited company. The beneficiaries of this trust are other two private trusts. Now, it's basically a complex question. There is a private trust, right? The trustee of that trust, private trust, is a private limited company. And the beneficiary of this private trust are other two private trusts. Now, this private trust in question, in the center of this controversy, is having some capital gain. Now, the question is, who is going to pay the taxes on that capital gain?
The one who in whose hands capital gain tax is arising.
So, I believe that as simple as this question is, complex this question is, the answer is as simple as that.
Yes, because regardless of the structure, ultimately you will have to see at which level capital gain is arising and is whose hands capital gain is arising. And trust being a separate tax entity, obviously whichever trust or whichever tax entity's hands tax is arising, capital gain is arising, tax would have to be borne by that entity.
What is the validity of a will of a person of unsound mind?
No validity. But you will have to demonstrate that when the will was signed, that person was of unsound mind.
Raghav Anand, since partial partition is not legally tenable, then what is the procedure to make complete partition of HUF? And after complete partition of HUF, can HUF still exist and liable to tax?
No, once the partition takes place, then HUF ceases to exist. And he's right that partial partition is no longer permissible in any case.
And what is the procedure to make complete partition?
Civil suit. One of the family member would have to go to the court saying that I want partition of the family. And he will have to demonstrate that there are disputes within the family and whatever other things.
So even otherwise, you want to say that amicably, full partition is not possible. Let's say all the members of HUF sit down and then decide that let's we go for the complete partition of this HUF. Will it be possible, or only the suit is the right way?
even in that case, to the best of my understanding, the decree would have to be obtained from the court, or a declaration of partition would have to be obtained from the court, even if it is amicable. So amicable would essentially mean that they will not fight upon who is going to get what.
Okay. Civil suit. It's always advisable and better to obtain the decree of the court in order to avoid any kind of future litigations.
Yes.
Is registering of will better to avoid any litigation?
Yes.
At what age or stage in life? This is a very important question. At what age or stage in life an individual should start planning for succession planning? I mean, is there any ideal age or any break-even point like we all chartered accountants want to know? So what is the right time to start this activity?
We all are mortal beings. The moment we realize we are mortals, we should do it. Yeah, that's on the philosophical side. But essentially, the moment we have enough wealth to distribute, and we should start planning it at the early stage. There's no harm.
So, Gaganji, is there any provision of stamp duty when a property is transferred from specific trust to beneficiary?
I'll have to check the exception if there is any under the Stamp Act. I'm not very sure on that.
Okay. It's from Mr. Vijay Goyal. Please, if you could cover what all I can will, I mean myself acquired property, and if what if I have got something from my father, either through a will or some, basically he wants to say that he has some self-made property and some property from his father. Now, can I will this entire hodgepodge, or only the property which I have self-acquired can be willed to my legal heirs?
So if you are inherited any property from the parents or anyone else, once it becomes your absolute property, you can transfer it. You can put it in your will, and whatever, including your self-acquired property. So all, both the kinds of property can be further passed on.
Okay. This one is done. Okay. If a person wants to transfer 75% of his property to one child, which is a special child, and whether other son who gets 25% can challenge or create problems after his death?
He can dispute it, but as long as it is demonstrated that the will is genuine, then nothing else remains. So what you can do is probably create a private trust for the special child and appoint someone trustworthy as trustee, and either do it during your lifetime or you can do it by way of a will as well. And it ultimately also depend on who is appointed as the executory of the will. So if someone who is trustworthy, then yes. It is not, dispute cannot be ruled out, but what can be ensured is that the dispute is not sustainable.
I think there is a follow-up question from Mr. Manoj Kansal, even though it was asked earlier, but I believe it is connected to your answer right away. What are the benefits of setting up of a trust over a will?
So trust, as I said in the beginning, that trust you adopt only in a situation where you want to settle things during your lifetime. And you can create a private trust listing out and formulating all the policies in what manner assets have to be shared or the income are to be shared from those assets.
I believe the next question was already answered, but I'm just taking it again. Whether transfer of immovable property to trust subject to stamp duty?
Sorry, I missed the question. Can you please
repeat? Whether transfer of immovable property to trust, is it subject to stamp duty?
Yes. As I said, that to the best of my knowledge, there is no exception. But yeah, it would be subject to tax.
Okay, again, stamp duty payable on property transfer by way of will, I believe there is no such stamp duty. This question has already been answered also. Okay, is there an implication if a sibling raises a question on validity of will? For example, if one claim it is a coerced will.
As I said that there is no stopping to anyone to challenge a will. And if it is challenged, then obviously you will have to demonstrate before the court that that the will was signed out of free will. And to that, demonstrate that the witness who are there may vouch for that. So you may have two or three witness to the will while signing the will.
Okay, there is a practical question from Mr. Sushil Jain. He says, Gaganji, you said that choice between will and private trust shall depend on the facts and circumstances of each case. Now, can you give us some illustration that how one form is preferable over other? Where will is preferred or where private trust is preferred?
So, in the beginning, I talked about Rockefeller family of US, or in the more contemporary time, if you see the arrangement between the Jindal family, at Mr. O.P. Jindal and his children. So that was carried out by way of a trust. And as we can see that things which are carried out through a trust are usually amicable and businesses thrive. But looking at also the questions on which we are getting on will, you can very much make out that it is not free from dispute. So the person who may have written the will may have passed away, but would have left a legacy of dispute amongst the sibling. So, depends on facts of each case. But usually in case of a small family where you just have one son, one daughter, you may survive with a will. But if you have a larger family, it is advisable to have a trust during the lifetime itself.
Okay, Gaganji, we still have 21 more questions to go.
Yeah.
Next question is from Mr. Devinder Singh Nagpal. Once the will becomes operational, then is it necessary to get the property registered in favor of the beneficiary?
Yes.
If yes, is there any time period for this?
I'm not sure on the time period, but earlier it is done, the better it is.
Okay. From Mr. Siddhant, if the title in hands of the will executor is disputed, can the co-partner, I believe this question is related to HUF, can the co-partner file the suit and take forward the dispute?
So this dispute would be intertwined, because if one disputes the authenticity of the will per se, then the rest of the issue would automatically follow.
Does will override the nomination that has been done on financial instruments? Usually generally in LIC or any other financial instrument, who generally nominate somebody, right?
Yeah.
And let's say will appoint somebody else. So in that case, well, whether will supersede that nomination?
Will supersede, because nomination is not as good as will.
Is there any stamp duty on family settlements?
Yes, that we have already covered. If there is immovable property in the family settlement, then yes, certainly there would be.
Again, I believe this question has been already asked. In case of private trust, at the time of transfer, any asset to trust and at the distribution of asset, both the transaction are tax exempt?
Yes.
Can an individual transfer ancestral property received by him, by way of, I believe this has already been asked, in the earlier question when property was self-acquired as well as acquired from father, I believe this has been answered.
Yeah. Vijay Goyalji asked, I think, this question.
Manoj Gupta ji, I believe, is not telling any question. He's stating some facts. He says that HUF cannot gift. Is it true, sir?
I don't see any bar on gifting.
Okay, from Karan Chabra, can HO be formed with only female members, and how can funds property be transferred to HOF? Any tax implications? Please guide. I believe already Hindu Succession Act has been amended.
Yes,
sir. Please.
And in any case, this would sound more like advising on how to circumvent the law. So I will refrain from answering this question at this forum. Maybe privately we may have a separate discussion as to tax planning. But yeah.
Which are the act which needs to be referred for succession in UP? I believe again it's a very blanket kind of question.
Essentially, you'll have to check what are the implications on transfer of immovable property. Rest of the things, I think, are mostly governed by the state and central acts.
Will the unregistered will supersede the registered will?
If it is not disputed and if it is signed later on, there could be dispute with regard to that, but you'll have to demonstrate that the unregistered will was signed later on and it essentially revoked the registered will.
So basically, whatever is the latest will,
yes,
if it is undisputed, yes, it can be registered or it can be unregistered, it will supersede any other will.
Yes.
Can Karta or son of Karta as co-partner ask for full settlement as partial settlement is not possible when other co-partner, that is uncle, does not want to divide or want partition and had a wrong intention? I mean, this is very Tanmay, you have to reframe your question because there.
No, I think I understood. I understood the question. So essentially, what he's saying is that assuming one of the family or the head of the family is not in favor of partition, can the rest of the family member ask for partition of the Hindu undivided family? The answer to that is yes, they can ask for it. And obviously it would be a dispute. So it will go on.
Deepak Kapai from Jammu. Is the property held in joint names despite payment being made by one party only? How should that be executed keeping the main party in mind?
See, we'll have to go by the legal ownership. If legal ownership is in the joint name, then the person having his joint name can only transfer his share of the property.
In one of the cases of Mr. Manoj Kansal, after death of Karta, the HOF was dissolved amicably by way of an arrangement agreement, and the income tax department was duly intimated, and all the assets, including bank balance, were equally distributed between the co-partners. Is there any problem with such an arrangement or anything which they have missed?
I think you should also obtain a declaration from a civil suit just to cover all the issues.
Just a follow-up question, Gaganji. He said that this has been distributed equally between the co-partners. Now, what are the role of members who are not co-partners here?
So since it's an HEF, so and Karta has passed away, and the next elder may not have agreed to become a Karta, and they all have dissolved it unofficially, so as to say. So rest of the anyone who is outside the family in any case has no role to play. The only thing would be that just to formalize the dissolution of or the partition of HEF, it would be better that declaration from court is obtained, from a civil suit, a civil court is obtained.
Now, let's say I take an example. Let's say there is an HUF where father has died. That father has four sons. Hmm. Out of those four sons, again, two sons have already died. So we are left with wife of the Karta, which is the wife of the father. Then two sons who are alive. And then two wives or daughter-in-laws. So we have in totality five members of this HUF, three wives and two sons. And out of these five, only two are co-partners. Now, while partitioning this HUF, how many shares we have to make? Will it be only two? Because at present, only two co-partners are there.
So So I think this is a little different from the usual succession, because partition of HUF is not on the basis of whether they'll get equally or not. Hmm. If it is usually either the family amicably agrees upon, or you go to the court.
Okay. Now, can settlor and trustee of trust be the same person?
Yes, there is no bar.
HUF can't be dissolved full partition with suo motu affirmative consent of all partners without involvement of court. Is civil suit is necessary?
Yes, to the best of my understanding, yes, because it's a legal entity and there's only one way to kill it.
Any suggestion on books or set of books for, I believe this has already been answered. Is it not, from Mr. Vijay Koyal, that by creating a private trust, you are putting administrative burden on the beneficiaries, especially when the settlor is no more?
Settlor in any case goes out of the picture after creating the trust. So it is on, the burden is on the trustees. And usually trustees are someone who is very close confidant of the settlor. Or in certain cases, these days we have a concept of professional trustees as well, who charge certain fees from the estate of the trust. So be that as it may be a burden on the trustee, but at the same time, it's a vehicle which preserves the wealth of the family. So you'll have to evaluate the cost benefit analysis would have to be carried out.
Gaganji, is it possible that, let's say, I have made a private trust and I have appointed two trustees, and later on one of the trustees says that, okay, no, I am no more willing to perform my duties as a trustee. So what is the legal remedy, or what are the legal recourse available to that trustee?
So all these eventualities are usually defined in the trust deed when we are forming the trust deed, that what happens if the trustee resigns, what happens if trustee also passes away. So all those eventualities are built in in the trust deeds to address all those possibilities.
Can a private trust be structured in a manner that in my lifetime, I retain the property, but let the income therefrom go to the beneficiaries? And after my lifetime, the concerned property gets devolved on those beneficiary in a ratio which may be different from the income distribution.
No, I don't think that is possible. You will have to, you can transfer the property after the lifetime only by way of will. So if you transfer the property to a private trust, and which is an irrevocable trust, then you have no control over it. Once you lose the control, then it goes, only then it goes to the private trust. If you want to retain the control, then it is better that that property transferred to the trust by way of a will.
Can immovable property be sold by the guardian in case of will created in the name of minor child and the writer of the will is deceased?
It can be.
Okay, can you explain the procedure of probate in one or two lines if it's possible?
So essentially, in case of probation, the will is produced before the court, and if anyone has challenged, they come up with those challenges. Otherwise, the court applies their own wisdom and see whether the will appears to be genuine or not. If it appears to be genuine, or once the court holds it to be genuine, then they simply certify it, and that's called probation.
Now, can rights of a daughter-in-law in property of the family be superseded by way of will or trust or settlement?
Yes.
Can there be a clause in trust that in case beneficiary ill treats settlor, then property of the trust shall go to another person or to a charitable trust?
Sorry, come again.
Let's say I have prepared a will appointing somebody as a beneficiary, and I also insert a clause in that will that if you mistreat me, then you will no more be the beneficiary and it will ultimately go to somebody else or some trust.
That is the case of Vijayapat Singhania and Gautam Singhania. So once it is transferred, then you can't take it back. Although I think now Section 125 of CRPC has been amended, whereby if the parents are ill-treated by the children, then it is the duty of the children to take care of the parents, and they can ask for the maintenance under the provisions of CRPC.
Okay, last two questions we will take up and then we will wrap up this session. This is from Mr. Samarth Sundana ji. He says, what if I have shifted from one state to another state, or in case of change of address, do I require to re-register my will?
You may not be, but it is better to avoid any kind of dispute, because you see, all these things come to the fore when the person who has made the will is not there. And in that event, if they are aware where it is registered, or if the executory is made aware of those facts, then there may not be any issue. But you will have to keep it somewhere handy that people know where it is.
Okay, sir. Last question from Mr. Gagan Singh.
Yes.
Do you advise the will writer should share the particulars of the will among the beneficiaries of the will or the various legal heirs?
Entirely depends on the equation within the family.
So I believe this was a very fruitful session. Already we have answered more than 75 questions, Gaganji. I believe it's not even 75, I believe it's around 90 questions we have already answered. So it's the record in our last four webinar. It's a record of a kind of a record that we have answered so much of the question. So with this, I would like to ask Mr. Gaurav Garg, if he's present, to propose a word of thanks to our today's faculty, Mr. Gagan Kumar.
Gagan bhai, thanks a lot. On behalf of complete FTAP team and all the participants, though I was mute listener to what you were saying, but yes, the way question and answer went upon from 11:45 or 11:40 till 12:20 or 24. So approximately for almost 35 minute to 40 minute, we had a question answer session. And for almost 30-35 minutes, we had your presentation. So I think a lot of practical queries or a lot of practical issues got resolved through your exposure and knowledge, which you gave without any restriction to all of us. We would again to call you back on Zoom for this session. I'm just wondering if this session would have happened at the Jaipur, which the conference which we planned, I think it would have been more wonderful. So, logon ne ho sakta hai aapko question answer chalte rehte. Nevertheless, thanks a lot, Gagan bhai, for joining. Thanks a lot to Deepak bhai, and thanks to each and every participant who is there, who joined the session. Thank you, everyone. See you tomorrow. Tomorrow we're going to have session on GST. We have Dr. Arpit Haldia to take this session. We're going to share the details soon on the WhatsApp group. Thank you.
Thanks, Gaurav. Thanks, Deepakji. And thanks to the audience.
Thanks, my attendees. Thanks, everyone. Thank you. And one more question. Not only on GST, we will be having two more sessions in the coming days. One session will be on Code of Conduct. It will be taken by Mr. C.V. Sajan. And then another, we will be having a very high-powered session with one of the CEOs, who's also a chartered accountant of a listed, he's a CEO of a listed company. We will have a power question answer session with him. The Rubaru series we have started in FTAP, we will be having that session also. So with this, I am signing off with, on behalf of my entire team of FTAP, I would like to thank everyone for attending this session. So we had to return a lot of attendees, because at one point of time, we already had crossed more than 104 participants. And since there is a limit of 100 participants, Zoom started kicking out those participants and had received a lot of messages on my WhatsApp that I'm not able to log in. So in that case, I will suggest that we will be sharing this recorded session with all of the members of FTAP. And they can very well watch this fruitful session at the comfort in their home. So with this, Thank you very much.
One thing I would like to say that the session which we are conducting on Saturday, the CEO session which talked with Deepak Bhai just mentioned. So, ये जो हमारे friends industry में हैं, जो young chartered accountants industry में जाना चाहते हैं, जो students हैं, उनके लिए बहुत important है. Because जो अपने panelist आएंगे Saturday को, he is a CEO of a listed company. So, journey of a chartered accountant from chartered accountant to CEO, उन्होंने क्या challenges face करे, किन तरीके से उन challenges को resolve करा, क्या vision रहा, क्या मेहनत करी, वो सभी पहली बार आप सबके सामने शेयर होगा. जैसे चोपड़ा सर ने अपनी वर्ड्स ऑफ विजडम, अपना एक्सपीरियंस शेयर किया, वैसे ही एक सीईओ हु इज नॉट अ वेरी सीनियर गाय, इन द सेंस यंग गाय, लेस देन 50 सीईओ है,
44 जस्ट
43 42 तो नहीं है दीपक भाई,
43 है, 76.
तो दीपक भाई के बड़े ही क्लोज फ्रेंड है, 43 इयर्स ऑफ गाय हु इज द सीईओ ऑफ अ लिस्टेड कंपनी. इट वुड बी इंटरेस्टिंग टू हियर हिज जर्नी एंड हिज वर्ड्स ऑफ विजडम. विद दीज वर्ड्स, थैंक्स एवरीवन.
थैंक यू.